Hi all, this is Dennis, and you are on the Den Electro channel. Today I will show you how to make such a switching power supply on a DK1203 chip. In previous videos, I have already shown how it is possible to assemble 6-volt, 12-volt power supplies on it. This power supply will output 9 volts with a maximum current of 1 amp. The power supply is assembled according to the scheme taken from the datasheet of the microcircuit. I just changed the ratings of some parts. On the left, an alternating voltage of 220 volts is applied to the input of the circuit. And on the right, the output is a stabilized voltage of 9 volts. The heart of the power supply is the DK1203 chip. It operates at a frequency of 65 kHz and controls the transformer T1. The transformer has only two windings, primary and secondary. Usually flyback converters have a power supply winding for the microcircuit, but here it is not. The primary winding is divided into two half windings, each with 60 turns. The secondary winding has only 13 turns. Almost all parts of the power supply are easily accessible. They can be taken from some old household appliances. The power supply should start with the manufacturer of the transformer. The core for its manufacture can usually be found in computer power supplies or fluorescent lamp ballasts. You see the dimensions of the core on your screens. For this type of power supply, the core must have a non-magnetic gap. This core has a gap between the middle posts and its distance is approximately 0.4 mm. If your core does not have such a gap, then the column can be filed with a file. Or put something under the side columns of paper or tape. But then the gap should be made twice as small. I will take the wire for the primary winding from such a coil. These can be found in old disc electricity meters. My core frame looks like this. It has four legs. First, I will wind 60 turns. This is half of the primary winding. I will use a double wire, since there is a lot of space on the frame on the thickness of the wire. You cannot save, and due to this, the winding will heat up less. The thicker the wire, the lower the losses on it. I start on left leg. I start the occasion on the left behind the frame, and take it out on the right. Thus, one turn is obtained. Then you need to make another 59 exactly the same turns. When the primary semi-winding is ready, the wire must be fixed so that it does not run away anywhere. If it turned out for you like mine on top, then it can be glued with adhesive tape. And if it turned out to be from below, then you can wrap it on the right leg. Then you need to make two or three layers of insulation, either from adhesive tape or from thin electrical tape. I will be using Mylar tape. Then I turn the frame on the other side. Here I will wind the secondary winding. I will wind with a three-core wire. The diameter of each core is about 0.3 millimeters. I start on left leg. On the left, I also wind up behind the frame and take it out on the right, so one turn is obtained. Then you need to make another 12 turns. At the end, the wire will come out on the right side and can be wound around the right leg. Then again, make 2-3 layers of insulation. I turn the frame back towards me with the side of the primary winding. I take the end of the wire that I have left and wind another 60 turns in the same direction. This will be the second half of the primary winding. Then the tape is wound from the outside, but this is optional. After winding the windings, we insert the frame of the cores and tightly tighten the halves with adhesive tape. If you wish, you can connect them with glue. On the side of the secondary winding, I did not solder the ends of the wires to the legs, but on the side of the primary winding, I soldered them. The inductance of the primary winding turned out to be 1300 microhenries. If you do not have an inductance meter, then you can make it yourself. I showed you how to do this in one of my previous videos. The link will be in the upper right corner and in the description. Next, I will tell you more about some of the details of the power supply. It looks like a DK1203 chip in a DIP 8 package. She has 8 legs, 3 of which are not used. I bit off the legs numbered 1, 4, and 6 so that they do not interfere with me. I will use the Soviet Terminator D814A as a Zener diode. It was released in the 82nd year, but it can still serve. In general, absolutely any Zener diode with a voltage of 8 volts is suitable in this power supply. But if you use exactly the same Zener diode as mine, then keep in mind that these Zener diodes have some voltage variation. They come in from 7 to 8.5 volts. I will take a high voltage capacitor for 10 microfarads, 400 volts, from the LED light bulb board. You can also take the MB10F diode bridge there. Despite its meager size, it can withstand a current of 0.5 ampere and a voltage of 1000 volts. I will wind the L1 throttle on such a dumbbell. You can see its dimensions on your screens. The wire is used the same as in the secondary winding of the transformer, only I fold it not into 3 cores, but into 2. It is necessary to make from 12 to 15 turns to make the inductance 10 microhenries. I will assemble the power supply on the board for homemade products. It is about the size of a matchbox. In addition to the existing holes in it, I made more holes so that the transformer is inserted and the legs match the holes. In them, I stuck the ends of the secondary winding. After installing the transformer, you can begin to create a power supply. After all the work done, you get such a compact, cute power supply. The location of all elements basically correspond to the scheme. From below, I installed a diode bridge and a D5 diode. To connect the rest of the details, I made tracks from wires. The first inclusion of the power supply must be done through an incandescent lamp. After switching on, a voltage of 9.2 volts appears at the output of the power supply. A slightly higher voltage is related to the type of Zener diode used. If after turning on nothing is heated anywhere, then you can connect a small load. In addition to thermal protection and overload protection, this power supply has output short circuit protection. When I bridge its output with a wire, the voltage sags and it goes into protection. To make a full-scale test, I will connect an electronic load to it. I showed how to assemble such an electronic load on LM317 chips with a power of 200 watts in one of the previous videos. The link will be in the upper right corner and in the description. As you can see, the power supply perfectly holds a current of 1 ampere. The voltage almost does not sag. Let's see what happens if we increase the load. 1.5 amperes for the power supply is not the limit. The voltage is still within normal limits. But here we must not forget that the output diode on this power supply is designed for only 2 amperes. I increase the load further, and after 2 amperes the voltage sags. The power supply went into protection. If the load is gradually reduced, the power supply returns to normal operation. Below the video, I will leave a link to the board layout. There is a project that I used in the previous video, but I changed all the denominations of the parts to this power supply. Please note that 1N4007 diodes are used there, and not a diode bridge in an SMD package like here. If someone still does not understand some points on the creation of this power supply, then I recommend that you familiarize yourself with the previous videos on this chip. Links to them will be in the description. That's all for today. Like this video, write comments, click on the bell, subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and bye-bye.